boosted the industry, even though it may have weakened certain markets. So if you take your area, for example, there are now three big casinos in Philadelphia, which are very prosperous, but they've taken some out of Atlantic City. Mm-hmm. There's some coming in Maryland, Delaware. The whole region has been really populated pretty heavily with casinos. Now the aggregate volume is enormous and much bigger than it used to be.
Really?
Yeah.
I don't know what the heck I'm going to do when I retire. I'll have to go find all this stuff myself.
No, it's growing the market. Pennsylvania now receives more money in gaming taxes than any state in the United States by a wide margin.
Really? Yeah. Why is that?
High tax rate and very prosperous businesses in Philadelphia.
No, I'm not anywhere close. Fortunate or unfortunate, I'm not quite sure.
And we have one in Atlantic City, is it really tanking?
It has really taken a hit, yeah.
Actually, it's just going to do something.
Lost almost 40% of its volume from its peak.
Wow.
Yeah. And all the drive-in business has really been pretty much eviscerated because people can go to Philadelphia, they don't need to drive their way. So we just get the people that come for an overnight visit.
So you're going to pull out?
No, we own about half of Atlantic City, so we can't really pull out. We keep finding ways to shrink a little bit and be more efficient and add new segments of business, but we've lost a lot of revenue and a lot of profitability there. Philadelphia is going to put another casino in the city now.
It's never as straightforward as it looks.
Add a third downtown casino somewhere, so that'll just make it worse.
Yeah.
And I have all these people that work for me
perhaps
that sometimes do what I want them to do.
Probably the most likely spot.
Really? Really? Yeah. You get sometimes?
Sometimes.
I need some tips from you.
Sometimes.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. And welcome to all of you who are viewing online. I hope there are a lot of you. I'm Stephanie Ilgenfritz. I'm the Bureau Chief of the Health and Science Group at the Wall Street Journal. And with me today is Ralph Dellatore, Chairman and Chief Executive Officer of Steward Healthcare Systems, and Mark Bertolini, Chairman and CEO of Aetna, and Gary Loveman, Chairman and CEO of Caesars Entertainment, and Zeke Emanuel, who is chair of the Department of Medical Ethics and Health Policy at the University of Pennsylvania and a former White House policy advisor. Welcome, gentlemen. So this is the cost of care containing healthcare spending in the era of the Affordable Care Act. And one thing we'd like to do today is kind of broaden the conversation a bit beyond just a partisan debate over the merits of the law and talk about some of the larger issues that are facing healthcare, which arguably predate the law and are larger than the law. So to begin, I'd like to actually, I think, step back for a moment and ask a pretty basic question that might seem obvious, but I think is probably a good place for us to start our conversation. And that is why? Why do we need to change the way we deliver and pay for healthcare in America? Arguably, healthcare costs have been slowing in recent years, although there's a lot of debate as to whether that's sustainable. So why do we need change? And I thought maybe, Gary, I'd start with you because you have talked a lot about the need for change and the need for employers to be able to have more authority to manage their health benefits under the law. What is at stake if we do not contain healthcare costs?
Well, I think what's at stake is that a disproportionate amount of everyone's effort goes to a result that is not commensurate with what we have to spend on it. And what we need to be able to do generally is to allow informed decision makers, patients, physicians, care providers generally, make rational decisions about what expenditures make sense for the furtherance of their health and the prevention of ongoing health problems. And I think by being able to put that sort of information, capacity, and the right incentives in the hands of these decision makers, we can do a lot. And I think many companies have experienced a tremendous degree of success in getting people to modify their behavior in a way that makes them healthier, takes on greater responsibility for preventative care, and yields a result that's favorable for all the participants in the mix. And I think that's really fundamentally what we're striving for. Now, the question of the degree to which the law enhances or fails to enhance that is another matter, but I think that's the holy grail of this, putting aside insuring everyone who isn't otherwise insured and so on. But for those, anyone who is insured, that's really what we're aiming for.
In 2012, the United States spent $2.87 trillion on healthcare. And to put that in some context for you, that makes the American healthcare system the fifth largest economy in the world, bigger than the French economy. It is just staggeringly huge. And we are growing at GDP plus 2% for the last 40 years. If we don't do anything, by 2040, one out of every $3 is going to healthcare and nothing else. And most of us don't think that's the best investment. And we're not getting that much great health for it. We're not number one in any category of health outcomes. So we could improve our quality. And by the way, I don't think it should just be the cost of care, because none of us want to just cut the cost of care or control the rate of growth without improving the quality of care. And I would say that probably everyone here thinks the best way to control healthcare costs is actually to improve what we're doing in terms of healthcare. And from my perspective, one of the main things we're going to do over time is keep patients healthier. And that's going to be a major way of controlling costs. And that's good on the quality front. It's good on the cost front. And we have to do it for what Gary said, because health is important, but it's not the only thing. We also care about education. We care about the environment. We care about lots of other things that need resources.
So, well, one of the challenges, if you're going to be containing costs, is maintaining quality. There are we hear a lot about things like accountable care organizations that are supposed to improve quality while lowering costs. And how is that going to work? I think you probably have part of an ACO in your system. How can we reduce costs and still maintain quality?
So our system is completely structured as an ACO. We have an entire vertical within the healthcare, from full at-risk products all the way through to home care and hospice and everything in between. I think that one of the definition of quality is what's important. So, many Americans conceive of quality as being able to obtain absolutely anything at any point in time for any reason. And that doesn't translate into measurable outcomes from a population health perspective. So we need to invest money to get a better total outcome for our population, not just to ensure that end-stage disease gets, you know, a two-month longer mortality or two-month longer survival. You know, one of the main issues that we, you know, talk about is that there is a disconnect between the investments in prevention and wellness and the fruits that bear from it. One of the problems that we're struggling with is when we look at employers and have discussions with employers around wellness, around prevention, disease management, most employers fully realize that the investments they are making, they're not going to get the fruits of. You know, no one stays in the same employee in this country for very long. And for the most part, with just minor changes that we've had in population management, no one really gets sick to the degree that we think of before the ages of 65. So in many cases, what we're doing is we're funding wellness, prevention, and disease management, not in every case, but in many cases, on the backs of the employers and the people that are going to reap the benefit of it is Medicare and the government. Yet Medicare refuses to even have its patients pick a primary care doctor. So there's a total disconnect between who bears the cost of the upfront components of wellness and prevention and who bears the benefit of it.
Is this the responsibility of employers? I know, Mark, you've talked about Aetna as an employer and the success you feel you've had with wellness programs. Is it cost effective for the employers?
I think the issue really is what do we define as a good outcome? And if we were to define health as getting people to a healthier status so that they're more productive, so that they're economically viable, and therefore they're happier, and that you create communities of individuals like that, I'm not quite sure the employer solution is the long-run solution. I think the long-run solution are health systems engaged with their communities to manage the health of that population. Now, we've had great success with our employee population because our turnover is in low single digits. We know who they are. We have all the data, and we're able to influence their behaviors in a number of ways, both through economics but also through other incentives, that last year for Aetna reduced our healthcare costs by 7.5%. Our costs went down. And so I think that, so it's really about population health management in a fundamental way where you understand the demography, the disease burden, the social, economic, cultural, environmental trends of a community, and your health system is structured to improve the health of that population, to improve their economic viability through a more productive and happier citizenry. That should be the definition of health.
But Mark has just made a point that I think needs to be pulled out a little bit. So for us, when we as an ACO enter into a community, it is vital and essential that we capture the community throughout its entire age process. So what do I mean about that? So when we go into a town or city, it is important to us that we're just not one piece or one segment of the population, but the entire population. Therefore, when we as a system put in preventative measures, put in wellness, disease management, all these things that bear fruit, whether the patient is, as long as all of our contracts are ACO-like contracts, whether that patient works for employer A or employer B or transcends into Medicare, we actually have and hold on to that patient for the entire continuum of their life, and we are engaged with that patient. It breaks down if the market becomes segmented and you have different systems or different providers or different employers at different stages. So as a system, it works well for us, but I do recognize that there is a disconnect with the employer and what they pay and what they bear for.
Let me try to frame it slightly differently. If you look at healthcare spending today, it's very lumpy bumpy. Half the population is basically out of the healthcare system, uses almost no dollars. 10% of the population uses two-thirds of the dollars, and they're people with chronic illness. If you want to control costs and you want to improve quality, you got to focus on that 10% today. Those are people with heart disease, they're people with congestive heart failure, with emphysema, with diabetes, with asthma. And keeping them healthy, what the docs call tertiary prevention, so keeping people who have a disease healthy is critical to saving money. So you got a diabetic, They have a little nick on their foot. If you don't take care of that wound, it'll get infected, they'll get gangrene, you'll need an amputation. Those are all unnecessary and eminently preventable outcomes. So intervening early, preventing things from getting worse on people who have illness, that is the intermediate and most important way we're going to control costs over the next decade. The things about changing eating, changing exercise, getting people to stop smoking, all of which are really important, vital, those are about community interventions, they're about public health interventions, and those have a longer time scale. It's incredibly important to do them, but those payouts are longer timelines. And so we need to do both. It's not either or. The tertiary prevention is what is, over the next 10 years, going to make a big difference in terms of the quality of the system and in terms of cost control. This other prevention, diet, smoking, exercise, that's a 20-year investment, and I think you've heard it exactly right. The incentive structure for insurance companies or employers to invest in that is all screwed up now because they don't reap the benefits. And so we're going to have to change that kind of incentive structure, and that, I think, is a big issue. But that really, in many ways, fell outside of what we were trying to do in the Affordable Care Act.
Well, I mean, as a CEO, let me take a counterintuitive response to that argument, because I think even in a high turnover industry like mine, where we have a lot of frontline people looking after our guests, there's a strong incentive for us as employers to engage in wellness activities with our employees, and that is because it's so motivating to the people who work for us that they have found a partner who's interested in their care. All the gentlemen and ladies on this panel are talking about systemic solutions to this problem, and the employer can play a vital role. I can put a nurse practitioner in the employee dining room where all my employees eat their meals free every day and talk about nutrition and ask if someone is feeling poorly and go through various diagnostic procedures on hypertension, blood sugar, whatever it may be, and be very engaged. Even if the employee decides to leave me 6 months later, I'm not going to feel as if I lost my investment on this, because I have a person who sees their employment with Caesars as being part typical remuneration, but also the enhancement to their family's wellness that comes from the collaboration we have with them.
I think that is a great point, which is, think about the investment in wellness. Say the employer gets out of health insurance, like it looks like some are going to do, right? Does that mean they stop being interested in wellness? Absolutely not. Because a major component of wellness is not about healthcare costs. It's about absenteeism, it's about presenteeism, and it's about disability. And so I think what you're going to see is employers much more interested in wellness, not because of healthcare costs, but because of all these other benefits, motivation, being wanting to come to work, not having disabilities. And I think that's a very interesting phenomenon. They don't have to be invested in healthcare to be invested in wellness.
And actually, internationally, we're finding that it's the worksite safety groups and employers internationally that are taking on the wellness challenge.
Yeah.
Because they get the employees engaged, and it isn't about their healthcare costs, it's about a more productive workforce.
Yeah. Right.
But we're almost talking about different things, though. And, you know, back to the point that you were making, so just take it back. Everything's a spectrum. Okay, when you're 40, you eat like crap, you gain weight, you become borderline diabetic. Okay, all of a sudden in your 50s, you know, you're still eating poorly, you're not exercising, your blood sugars are high, you become an insulin dependent diabetic. In your 60s, it's out of control, you start getting peripheral vascular and heart disease. In your 70s, you have heart attacks, you have congestive heart failure, and in your late 70s and 80s, you utilize healthcare like a drunken sailor on shore leave. That's the spectrum. The sooner we intervene in that spectrum, the more benefit we as a society gain. The problem that we're facing now, and as Zeke pointed out well, is the disease management, that last component of it, i.e. you're diabetic and you've got peripheral vascular disease and you're taking care of a wound. That last component, you know, it's not Caesars who's paying for that component. The vast majority of those patients are either Medicare patients or dual eligibles under the current system. The vast majority. Okay? But yet, you know, the burden of preventance and wellness through the plans in Massachusetts and the Affordable Care Act fall upon the commercial plans to implement, where the real benefit of doing that implementation needs to fall within the Medicare or dual eligibles population, which we pay through our taxes. But we've got to push back and start putting those systems literally under the same structure that we put our commercial systems under. I mean, again, I keep coming back to it. I don't think there's anybody on this panel that thinks that having a primary care doctor is a bad idea. But Medicare doesn't require it.
Let's talk for a moment about the role of doctors. Two of you on the panel are physicians, who are arguably the gatekeepers. They order all the tests and treatments and services that... And I'll just start with Zeke, because you've written about that doctors need to embrace this role a little more. And should doctors be considering costs when they are making their medical decisions?
Oh, absolutely. But let me be very clear what I mean by that. I'm an oncologist, care for cancer patients. We have lots, I'll just give you an example, stomach cancer. You look at the guidelines, there are 20 flavors or more of chemotherapy, and they all produce the same survival. All right? The price difference between those 20 flavors of chemotherapy for six cycles of chemotherapy, roughly 6 months, $1,000 to $55,000. 55-fold difference in price, exactly the same outcome. Now, why shouldn't a doctor consider the price in that context, where there's not a difference in outcome? So when you have interventions that are exactly the same, and there are plenty of them, why shouldn't price be an important component of your decision making? Well, I think that's a very legitimate consideration. And I think it's something that we have to be quite clear about. And so that's a very specific case, but there's a lot of cases like that in American medicine. Another one, there are eight hips, implantable artificial hips. In any given marketplace, there are vastly different prices. What do they vary? Fourfold, eightfold in the actual cost? Yep.
But then we start worrying about rationing of care.
That is not rationing of care. What did I just say? Where the outcomes are the same, right? That's exactly, that was the important point. That's why I said I wanted to be very careful here. That's not rationing. The outcomes are the same. We're not asking a patient, don't live 6 months longer. We're going to give you that cheap stuff. That's not where we have to go. That is not an issue that we have to confront at this point in time, and it's not a matter of rationing. I'm talking about where the outcomes are the same. Let me repeat it so there's no confusion out there in, you know, attack Zeke land. The outcomes are the same. Costs, absolutely. Why wouldn't you? When you go out to those shops on Fifth Avenue, doesn't it matter if you've got the same product and the costs are vastly different?
Ralph, I think you had a different perspective you wanted to offer.
I mean, I think that that's, you know, with all due respect, a beautiful point of view, but it's just not reality. I mean, sure, and you can point to some cases where that is true, where the costs are the same and the outcomes are the same. But that's not the easy dilemma that we have to face as society, right? The hard dilemma was, is it worth paying an extra $100,000 to live 3 months more, or $200,000 to live 6 months more, or $1 million to live 2 years more? That's the dilemma that we really are going to define ourselves by in the future. That's the dilemma we need to start thinking about. And if you put doctors in that position, I think it's unethical. Basically, we're abdicating our role as society and of the people that we elect to make those tough decisions, and we're putting it upon the physicians. A physician should be a defense attorney for their client. Can you imagine if you said to defense attorney, public defense attorneys, I'm sorry, you know, you have to start managing every case and defending every person based on cost of how long it's going to be, there would be a tremendous uproar in this country. So, I mean, I think that no one disagrees with that comparative effectiveness research. I don't view everything the same as being part of, you know, understanding cost and making decisions based on cost. I think that's just good medicine. It's pure basic comparative effectiveness research, and I would not disagree one with what you said, completely with what you said. But that's not the tough dilemma. Those aren't what we really talk about when we talk about decisions being in the line of cost. We're asking physicians to make decisions as to what is the time value of a life moving forward. Is it 100,000? Is it a million? Is it 1,000? And I tell anybody, if you're 90 and it takes $1,000 to get you to live to 6 months, everybody would say, great. If it cost 100 million, everybody would say, that's crazy. We got to define it as society. It's not right to put doctors and nurses in the position to make those decisions just because we won't do it.
I think there's a much more comfortable middle ground in most cases that we deal with. So if people are suffering from non-life-threatening chronic pain, for example, and there are lots of ways to treat that, and we observe when you look at the data, either in a company like mine or in the Medicare data, these enormous heterogeneities across practice patterns that are a function of how physicians are trained or what technology exists, the supply side of the medical system in a certain locale. And these are things that can be arbitraged, I think, without raising the ethical dilemmas broadly that are described. These debates are almost always taken at the extremes of end-of-life care and a lot of these other very valid, very pressing conditions. But in the middle, there are all kinds of simple circumstances with tremendous resource expenditure that could be rationalized, I think, fairly easily. And in my view, and I think most economists' view, you have to make the patient have some responsibility for the marginal nature of that decision and let them decide, am I taking the baby to the emergency room tonight with the sore ear, or will I call into the nurse that Mark's company provides to see if I really need to take the baby into the emergency room on Saturday night? These are the cases that are, I think, are much more straightforward.
And you're comfortable with those cases because the outcomes, as best as we can tell, right? Not that different.
That's right.
Undifferentiated.
Yeah, right. Yeah. And I would disagree. I think actually the situation I described, while it may be most apparent in the gastric cancer case that I gave you, is not at all that extreme. We have lots of cases where different patterns of care result in the same outcome, and as best as we can tell, that price differences are very high. And why do we tolerate heavy expenditure when you can get the same outcome?
But part of that problem, Zeke, is that in some cases the oncologists are advantaged by using the more expensive chemotherapeutic drug from the biosimilar.
I agree with
the manufacturer. So they've got a choice of eight, and the one that is $55,000.
And we're not incentivizing them in the right way.
So the structure of the reimbursement and the way you pay for it will have a dramatic change.
I agree.
And the biggest opportunity to do that is with Medicare. Because every time Medicare changes a payment rule and provides the right incentive, we get the right behavior because it's the largest payer we have in the country.
Look, I absolutely agree with you. And I've been advocating, as you well know, for a long time, we need to have a shift off the fee-for-service system. The fee-for-service system in medicine, just as in any other area, is you pay people to do more. Surprise, they'll do more. And we have it in medicine, and it's a serious problem. It's not the only problem we have in the system, and so we need an alternative payment system. There are a variety out there. There's bundled payment. There's the accountable care organizations where you pay an organization. There's capitation. And I think we need to shift to those. We can't shift overnight. Most systems aren't ready overnight. But we need an orderly, predictable timeline to shift. And I've been advocating for, these many years, since the day I got out of the White House, that is a crucial element that we need. And we need to shift the different payment change. And, you know, just tomorrow I'm hosting a meeting with payers like Mark's group and Medicare and others to try to say, you know, can we do this in cancer?
So, I mean, agreed. However, I would just want to give us our organization. Okay, the vast majority, if not over 90% of our commercial contracts are basically full risk cap. Our chemo drugs are average wholesale price plus 5%. So we've taken out of the equation the things that you just described in totality. The biggest problem facing us right now is the massive contagion effect of applying all the risk protocols and population management controls, because 60% of our population is Medicare, and Medicare, you cannot get them to engage in an ACO or any kind of realistic care management.
Well,
so until you can tackle that, everything that you do and everything that I do is at risk.
Medicare is like a blocking fullback going through the line. And if Medicare blows the hole open, we follow them through every time. And I pushed hard for, you know, us to coordinate with Medicare, because we could do dramatic change to the payment system, I think literally in a period of a year and a half, 2 years, if they would play ball that way.
Well, under the law, the ACO model under the law is a Medicare experiment.
Yeah.
And they have, that involves
a but that ACO experiment is a contrived experiment that really doesn't get at the underlying opportunities. And the ACOs that we're doing and the kind that Ralph are doing are really aimed at a far more robust model. And so the ACO, you can't win under the current ACO model of Medicare in any dramatic way, shape, or form.
Well, what
220, come on, Mark, let's be fair. 225 medical groups have gone into the Medicare ACO.
Right.
Now, with 4 million Medicare patients in them. So at least some people out there think that this is an important...
We're trying it.
An important experiment
right.
to go.
We're all trying it,
And you guys asked Medicare to do things. Now, I don't want to be here defending CMS and Medicare, but they have done some novel things. And let's be fair, They are the government, and they're under severe restrictions under what they can try and what they can't try. And every time they try something pretty novel, they get battered pretty hard. Mm-hmm. So let's be fair to what they're trying to do and give them credit. All right? They've penalized hospitals who aren't taking seriously hospital-acquired infections, medication errors, and other things. And guess what's happened? Hospitals are taking them real serious. So we put that in the Affordable Care Act. That's going to be both quality improvement, cost savings. Readmissions, your chance before the ACA, if you were 65 years and older, of once you're discharged from a hospital, of returning to the hospital was 20%, 1 in 5 within 30 days. We looked at that. We found it unacceptable. We put in a plan that began with 3 diseases and has already expanded to say, you know, you got to bring that rate down, or you're going to be penalized. Guess what? Every hospital is now looking seriously, trying to figure out how to bring those rates down. That's going to be quality improving, cost savings. The ACO is another model. I agree with you. They don't necessarily go full steam ahead. One of the other things we did do in the Affordable Care Act was, let's give a pot of $10 billion to run experiments and demonstrations. Not every one of them is going to be perfectly designed. Not every one of them is going to succeed. But we have to try more. That was the philosophy.
See, Zeke, I'm not criticizing the Affordable Care Act and all the things it's trying. What I'm trying to say is that if we're going to, the single biggest barrier to fixing our nation's debt is getting health care costs under control.
We're in agreement.
Right? And so if we don't do that, more than 70% of the next $10 trillion in debt of this nation is coming from health care.
We're in agreement.
And if we fix that, the $750 billion of waste we have every year, we can pay back a bunch of that debt. So if we were really serious about that, and instead of raising eligibility ages and turning people away based on means testing or whatever it is, and we actually fixed that nut, held healthcare costs flat for the next 5 years.
But how are you going to do that?
By fixing that nut. You have to make this payment reform dramatic and industry-wide. You have to...
We're in heated agreement.
Right. And so we have to... And so if we do that, I think we get there.
Well, but... So
Wait. I want to, this is on the record for the Wall Street Journal.
Yeah.
You
taking it all down.
Huh? They're gonna now put me on the payroll.
Yeah.
You say if we got payment reform across the industry,
right,
we could hold healthcare inflation to GDP plus zero.
I think we could do better than that.
I agree.
I think we could do better.
We're in heated agreement.
And if we go after that $750 billion a year in waste,
I agree.
We expand capacity in the system for people who are now going to have access because of the Affordable Care Act and won't be able to find it.
You heard it here first.
Right.
We get payment change, we can actually get health care inflation
under control. Let's do it.
So, but again, the big gorilla is Medicare and what we said earlier. And I actually don't agree with you on the ACO programs that are out there. The ACO programs are 20 years ago managed care Medicare. I mean, there's nothing novel about what we're doing. We're one of the pioneers. We're one of the 23 remaining pioneers that is supposed to be
the
cutting edge.
In three of them.
And we're having to dumb down what we do on commercial to meet their needs. Again, it is even in our pioneer ACO, we cannot tell a patient that they have to pick a primary care. It is absolute ludicrousy. You know, and then you say all the other ones, the shared savings. Come on. And shared savings, you're held neutral for GME and IME. In other words, you're allowed to pick the most expensive setting possible to deliver the care, and it's held neutral. I mean, these aren't real experiments. You know, to the honest truth is, we had this experiment. It's called managed Medicare. It actually cuts costs.
If we were to take payment reform seriously as a nation, work together between the private and public sector to make that happen, and drive it over the next 18 to 24 months. And I back to your earlier point, create focus factories that go after those individuals who are really sick today and driving half of our healthcare costs, we could hold healthcare costs flat.
I'm in agreement that we need payment reform, right? So, I think that's pretty universal. Yeah. And let me ask a question.
Can I just go back to this.
Yeah, 1 minute.
Now, I don't disagree with you that there's a more aggressive model of ACOs that the government could have done. But here's their dilemma, and I just want to try to explain as best as I understand it, and I may not understand it perfectly. You have this challenge. You, Stewart Medical, are really in shape to push the limit. How many other groups across the country are ready to push the limit? So you have to design a program where you'll get enough people in to run it, and you can't be at the front end where 0.1% of docs can do it. That's the Medicare dilemma. And so they design a program which you think is, you know, it's like putting on 5 pounds around my ankles. But part of their challenge is we have to make sure enough groups can participate in the program to make this a realistic test. That's the dilemma of the regulator at the government level. And I understand your frustration, which is, you know, let me free and I can show you how we can actually bring better management, bring better tertiary prevention, and really get costs under control and quality improvement.
So absolutely. As a physician, would you have designed any care management program that didn't have a primary care involved? So you were involved. You created health.
Look,
you know, you were there.
I'm not going to tell you what the problem is.
Where there's no primary care doctor even required. I mean, let's get to the basics of it.
I would agree.
There's a political expediency which is just not confluent with what we need to do in medicine right now.
I would agree with you that what we really want is people to sign up for ACOs and make a commitment and be there. That is a big culture change for Medicare, and I think that the people at Medicare running it thought that the program was not ready for that big a culture change in one step. I would agree with you. Signing up, having a primary care doc, committing to that primary care doc, especially since you probably had him or her for a long time, is probably an essential element of good health. And I think we're going to get there. The reason I'm optimistic is over the next 4 or 5 years, not only in the Medicare program, but through the exchanges, we're going to get there, where people have to commit to a primary care doc, a network that their primary care doc is part of, and that will allow much better management of patients.
Only we're not going to have enough primary care doctors. So
I don't agree with that.
I don't agree with that either.
Yeah. Well, there doesn't seem to be a lot of agreement on whether there truly is a doctor shortage, and maybe that'll be a conversation for another day.
Yes.
But we are in agreement, I think, that payment reform is something we all need to consider. Fee for service.
Absolutely.
Not consider. We have to do it.
Have to do it.
Have to
and
we, do
and,
it.
And I know that there are
it's
all
essential.
Sorts of experiments that out there, and a lot of it involves something that a word that came up a moment ago, capitation. So I'd like to ask a question about that, and I've asked this a lot, and I'm always interested in what the answer is. We've heard that term before. We've heard that before in the 90s, where the doctors or the system gets a set amount of money, and they cover the patient population for that, and they make money if they come in under. So, which is the way people tend to understand this notion of capitation. There are other sort of flavors of it today. So what's different? That's my question. What is different, how is it not a decision?
In the past, so in the 90s, I used to deliver capitation checks to providers' offices. And I used to show up with a green bar report about this thick, and it had two rubber bands around it, and underneath the rubber band was a check. And the green bar report had the patient's name, their social security number, their member number, and the amount of the check. And that was it. And I said, here's your capitation report, which was really just a ledger. We'll see you next month. And, you know, fortunately or unfortunately, hospitals operate on a revenue basis. Doctors work on a cash basis. And the whole notion of there are forward liabilities that I need to reserve for aren't there. What's different today is that the data systems are available to see where a patient is at almost any turn and understand what level of care they're getting and where they're getting it. And the more closed the system and complete and capable the system is, the more opportunity you have for managing within that dollar flow. We were flying blind. It was a great idea, but we had these laws that said if the physician groups blows up, the HMOs pay for it. So all of a sudden, capitation retreated to the smallest corners of California. And, you know, we've not come back from that.
So can you explain a little more about how is data making a difference? How do doctors and hospitals use data? Because it's an enormous investment up front.
Yeah. Well, so again, just to reiterate, so in a capitated, siloed environment where the doctors are a completely separate entity from the hospitals, from the payer, from the home care, from hospice, it fails. It fails for two reasons, because they're siloed and they're each incented to drive their own individual revenues to the max, and because data transfer and the integration of care across all those different silos does not happen effectively. So the solution is an integrated system. So how we do it, and I'll just give you two nuances, is we are at risk as an entire entity, not only with our employed physicians, but with all of our associated physicians. We are at full risk with them, with our hospitals, with our home care, with our hospice, with everything, all together, and it's all apportioned out. Now, Then the next question that always comes up is, how do you prevent rationing healthcare? Right? Even as a system, you can do it. So now we've eliminated, by doing it all in an integrated fashion, playing games within the silo, how do you not gang up? The way to do that is to construct a system where actuarial balance exists between quality metrics, which you measure and designate, and the payment of risk. In other words, it becomes impossible to limit care without costing yourself much on the quality metrics that get paid than what you get on the risk side. And therein, you balance, through that kind of structure, the incentives, so that your number one incentive is to provide the highest quality care possible, and we have hundreds of metrics that get measured. And then as a secondary, it becomes important then to, once that's done, to make sure that the right amount of care is delivered.
In a capacity misaligned system, which is what it is mostly today, the incentive under a global budget, I use global budget instead of capitation because capitation is a dirty word. We don't use capitation anymore. And what happens is from a place of care, you move out of the hospital into the outpatient, into the office, into the community, into the home. And so to the degree it's safe, you want to drive the care to the lowest cost venue.
Yes.
And then you want to drive it to the lowest cost provider within that venue, away from the specialist to the primary care, to the physician extenders, PAs, you know, certified nurse practitioners, massage therapists, acupuncturists, to the family member. And that's where you start to have an impact versus having to ration care. You reuse the capacity in a fundamentally mm-hmm. different way, engaging all the actors in the system. So that creates a healthier system.
Agreed. And let me emphasize the point that if you keep doctors and hospitals, home care, separate,
yes.
there is just going to be a food fight over who gets the last dollar.
Right.
Because if you actually keep patients healthier and out of the hospital loses revenue. And the doc or the home health care agency will make more revenue. And that'll just create a conflict unless there is some way of rationalizing that cost. Similarly, if all you do is capitate without data about who's at risk for using health care services, the doctors and the hospitals have a hard time identifying those people. So one of the things that's going to happen over the next decade is a much closer alignment between insurers who have a lot of data and information and analytic capacity to find out and identify who's at high risk and the provider and say, listen, you know, this person has got a 30% risk of being hospitalized in the next 2 years, right? It pays to invest today in that patient on the outpatient setting. I don't know what it is, but here's what, rather than have 30% risk and reduce that risk of hospitalization down to 10, 5, 2, whatever it is. That's where data comes in, and we didn't have that data in the 90s. The second thing is these quality metrics that can be recorded on a real-time basis are going to be essential to have electronic health records that get you those quality metrics instantaneously, and you can feed it back to doctors. Because what we have now are we collect quality metrics. 6 months later, you give them to the doctor. Well, what's 6 months? I forgot what I did before. I have no way of fixing it. And probably by that time, the patient's had an intercurrent illness that's wiped out whatever I'm supposed to do. So this ecosystem that we need to create, alignment between the hospital, the doctors, and other providers, fed by data that identifies high-risk patients in a real-time manner that's going to be enabled by electronic health records, we're just about to get there. We're not quite there. The best systems, Stewart and company, have that. But from the entire American healthcare system, we're not quite there. We now have, you know, a majority of doctors are getting wired up. The electronic records are still not perfect in that regard. Again, keep your eye on the ball. I said that the American healthcare system is the fifth largest economy in the world, right? You're not going to change it in 2, 3, 4 years. It's going to take the end of the decade. But by the end of the decade, we are really going to be in this very robust place that all of us are talking about. And that's going to be the moment where we're really going to be able to see a dramatic slowing of healthcare cost growth, I think.
Well, what do you say to a doctor who says, I don't want to practice medicine according to an algorithm. My patients are not data points, they're people. And this is cookie cutter medicine. There's always another aspect of evidence-based medicine where someone says that my patient is outside the evidence and I should practice this.
You know, but doctors can't possibly keep up with the evolution of scientific thought in healthcare today in any way, shape, or form without support from technology. And so even to the quality metrics, what you'd want to be able to do is say, you know what, Mark, you haven't had a hemoglobin A1C in the last 18 months, and that's in the doctor's hand before you even walk in the office. And they're waiting for you or calling you and telling you to come in to get treated because that improves quality. That's a quality indice. And that data is available today, and we can deliver that data. So doctors who refuse to do it that way need to retire.
Well, I mean, I'll be less draconian about that on the physicians. I mean, here at the heart of what is going on is that medicine, like many other industries, is undergoing a commoditization period. Everything goes from art to science to commodity, just like the car industry, the finance industry. During the commoditization phase, and this is what I call it, you know, two things need to be controlled. Cost, so that it can be made affordable to everyone, and quality, so you get a reproducible product. Okay. Now, when you take it down the commoditization period, it doesn't mean that the high performers back in the art phase are better off, right? A Scudera body on a Ferrari engine is still a gorgeous car, probably is today. But it's not a reproducible phenomenon for everybody. So what happens is you narrow the differential and the average gets raised. So are there great physicians, a handful of brilliant physicians who can outperform the studies? Yes, there are. I mean, it would be irresponsible to say, yes, there are. However, that is not the way to manage on a population basis, right? We have to narrow the gap and raise the entire quality across the entire population. And that's kind of what we're trying to get to. But I think that you have to be careful not to say that there is the absolute superstar physician to which the norm doesn't apply.
But I don't think you're commoditizing healthcare, though, Ralph. I don't think you're really commoditizing it. I think what you're doing is you're providing a level foundation that allows people to decommoditize the ultimate goal, which is the patient. You got a better patient.
Well, yeah, I think healthcare is an issue.
The role of the patient is really the essential piece that this debate has missed. Patients have to be better informed and better motivated to make sensible decisions to engage in the care of their own health and their family's health. And employer-based systems are very effective at this. Medicare is surprisingly ineffective at this. So people have to recognize that certain basic screening tests are going to be the best stalwart to some of the phenomenon my colleagues have been describing. That if they're given 30 pills and they're asked to take one a day, it would be nice if that prescription ran out after 30 days, not 75 days or 12 days. And a lot of these things are very basic things that can lead to tremendous enhancements in health, particularly in some of the more needy areas, and don't require enormously sophisticated systemic responses to try to address
it. People don't always like it. They don't want their employer or their insurer to, you know.
No, I think that that's a visceral reaction, Stephanie. I don't think that's the case, at least in our experience. We've said to people, to our employees, and many of whom are in some very tough health areas of the country, that here's the deal. You have the right to tell us to bugger off, but it's going to cost you $50 a pay period. It's your call. If you don't want to have your blood sugar checked, you don't want to have an EKG once a year, it's entirely your right, but you're going to have to pay for the right to ignore your health. If, on the other hand, you'd like to have the $50 benefit, we'll look after these things. And generally, even the most recalcitrant people who tend to be male and about my age ultimately are persuaded. At some point, they say, okay, uncle, for an infinite amount of money, I'll actually get my blood sugar checked, and I'll get an EKG, and I'll see if I'm, in fact, in terrible and increasingly frail health. And then a whole series of good things will happen, and the person will say, why was I such a dope?
So I think the carrots or the sticks?
Let's go to the cookbook medicine charge, because I do think it's very important to be clear. 80 to 90% of patients fall within the algorithms where we have algorithms, and there are plenty of things we don't have algorithms for. Okay? There are 5 or 10% of people who are unusual, 10, 20% in depending on what you're looking at. Mm-hmm. How would a doctor know how to treat a patient? Right? We know because of clinical trials. Right? Clinical trials take a variety of patients with a condition and tell us what the best way to go is. They are algorithm driven. Otherwise, the doctor is just guessing with no evidence. Guessing with no evidence, you may call that individualized care, but that is stupid care because it's got no evidence base behind it. If you agree that we need evidence to guide a doctor, that evidence comes from a trial, which is algorithm driven. So the idea that we can't engage in cookbook medicine flies in the face of how else are we going to get the evidence for what works and what doesn't work? There's no way a doctor can know without having an algorithm under there. We also recognize, look, we did a trial, people who were in the trial had this characteristics. This woman has a very unusual breast cancer, and it doesn't fit the categories. That's the 5 or 10% or 20%, depending upon your condition. That is unusual, and you're going to have to craft something different and admit at that point, we don't have the evidence for what we're doing. We are going on our intuition. But we should distinguish individualized care, which is intuition-driven, from standardized care, which is data-driven. Which do you think is likely to get you better care in the long run? You really think guessing is the way to treat patients best?
Well, and I hate to do this because I completely agree with what you're saying. I just don't want to be so absolute and black and white. And the example I'll give is a little different. You know, if you have an aneurysm in your aorta, and the statistics say when you look at huge cohort studies that at 6 centimeters in your ascending aorta, you should get operated on. Because if it's less than 6, your risk is X. Okay? That's a cohort study. All of a sudden, you know, if you're one of the surgeons at UPenn, who I know, who does 200 of these a year, whose individual year after year after year morbidity and mortality, because he does 200, not one or two, is 1/10 of that used in the study for comparison, and that patient comes to you, do you advocate doing it earlier rather than later? Because you know in your hands after 10 years of having 10 times the volume that a normal surgeon does, you know, you can do it better than the study that was reported. I mean, that's what I'm saying. I know those are the outliers, but I think it's important to understand that there are outliers. You know, and again, I want to come back a little bit to what we were talking about is talking and dealing with patients. You know, as much as I beat up on Medicare, and if you really want a diatribe, let me beat up on Medicaid, I think it's important for us to understand that the patients that commercial carriers and employers engage with is a very different population. Okay? If you are going to create a system where through emails and through, you know, text, you're going to communicate with the average Medicare or Medicaid patient, you will go bankrupt. Unless your patients are radically different than the million-plus Medicare patients that we have every day in our system, it's a different population. 30, 40-year-olds, 50-year-olds, 55, the people that we engage with in a commercial population is very different than the dual eligibles and the Medicaid, Medicare populations. So we have to at least remember that as we roll out cost savings. And I come back to it. From a population, the future of containing costs so that it doesn't hurt America is going to be much more on the government side, Medicare, Medicaid, and the government payers, than it will be on the commercial side. And we need to get the government proactively engaging where the commercial industry is now.
But the technology is still valuable.
Oh, absolutely.
In the dual eligible and Medicare population, because you can connect high tech with high touch.
Well, but on the provider side, right, and on the payer side, but right, not necessarily on the patient
right
side.
But you can still connect and you can get people. And so you have, now what you have is in keeping people in the home, a logistics issue.
Mm-hmm.
How do I get the right person to that place?
Yeah.
With the evidence I have, which may be a device in the home that's telling me how that patient's doing, one way or the other.
I agree with you, but I think it just, you know, we have the young patients in our commercial population with patient portals, and they log on, and they monitor their care, and they monitor their weight and what they eat, and they take good care of themselves. You know,
but they're not costing you money.
And I guess mean, what?
You've agreed. Most of those kids are healthy, and yes, they're wired up, and they're checking. Most of your Medicare patients are not checking, and you're going to have to provide personal care to them at this point in time.
But Ralph,
in the home.
We take care of more. Yeah. We take care of almost 2 million Medicaid members, and we, you know what we reach them? Texting on their cell phones.
No, then you got a different population.
It's no.
I got to pick up a few Spanish language texts.
State governments provide cell phones in a lot of places as part of the Medicaid program, and so you can reach them through their technology.
In Massachusetts,
I think what we're agreed to is there's not going to be a one-size-fit-all
for
contacting the patients. And you're going to have to, you know, if you're a smart marketer, you're going to have to figure out how you contact this patient population, how you contact that.
Right.
Yes, young, healthy people who, by and large, don't use a whole lot of health care, you know, virtual contact, whether it's email, text messages, fine. And that could be whether they're in the Medicaid population or not. Other populations, which aren't so tech-savvy and find it a little phobic, you're going to have to be more personalized. But there's going to be a lot of different ways. All of that can occur out of the hospital, at home, or in other low-cost settings. And that transformation is worth a lot of money.
Yeah, I would just add, you know, Ralph, in our day jobs, we put a lot of complicated incentives in front of people that are 65 years of age and older.
And they lose a lot of money.
That's right. God bless them.
Zeke meant to say they're very entertained. They make highly deliberative, reflective decisions. They just want the incentive. So if we say to elders or whoever it may be, we're going to communicate with you by text, and it'll save you this much money to do so. Here are the options that are available. It's rather astonishing how effective these
are. But I can't agree with you more. Right. I just want the ability the government will allow me to provide the incentive. Right now, I'm not allowed to provide the incentive.
And I would argue the biggest incentive is less about carrots and sticks and more about making it easy. So a lot of things you do is you make it so easy. Somebody walks in to your facility and you know they're a member, they get a message before they even know they have to talk to you.
Right.
And so the whole idea, and I think for 80% of the population that uses the healthcare system on an episodic basis, the better definition of quality for that population is going to be convenience.
Yeah.
It's easy for me to use the healthcare system. I'm managing my health. I'm not managing my healthcare. And I don't have to go through the labyrinthian systems that the sick people do to make sure that I'm doing the right thing for myself. And so that, I think, much like you do with your clients every day, is what we need to do in the healthcare system. From the buying experience up front, which we're about to see a little bit of here in the next few weeks, all the way through to how they access the healthcare system.
Yeah, I'll just give you a personal vignette. A few weeks ago, I was doing my duty as a citizen to get preventative service. I was going to get a colonoscopy, and the day before, the doc wanted me to get a blood test. I went to a facility to get a blood test, and I had to sit there for 40 minutes for a two-minute procedure. And they didn't, like, you know, restaurants, say, all right, what's your cell phone number? We'll send you a text message 5 minutes before your spot comes up. You know, it's absurd. Healthcare has never had to be in the service business.
Right.
And we are going to get in the service business because people like me and many others are going to be able to make decisions now on the exchanges with, and convenience, making it easy, is going to be an important criteria. And I think it ought to be an important criteria. 40 minutes of my time may not be valuable to the health system. It's pretty valuable to me. And waiting there and not having them adopt, you know, 1980s technology seems to me to be crazy. And so I think this is going to be one of the many areas where we're going to see big improvements.
Well,
and it's going to be thankful.
Well, time management is an excellent segue into our next phase. We're getting toward the end of our time.
Nice job,
and we're going to open up the floor to questions. And I hope that there's a microphone around that's available if anybody has questions, although it's a small enough room that probably it won't be difficult, but.
We're acting like we are the first country in the world to deal with healthcare. As I understand it, every other wealthy Western country has already been through this. So I have to assume that somebody does it well, and that perhaps we could look to them. I mean, why does it sound like we're
I spent a lot of time internationally in other countries, and they all have the same problem. Healthcare costs are breaking the bank. So they haven't solved it just by having the government pay for it. They have the same issues. Their systems have been built up in a Western model in the Western nations based on having everybody go to a hospital. And so you see different forms of rationing in those countries where they just don't have the capacity to take care of people. The work we're doing in China and the Middle East is around systems that are now emerging with middle classes that are emerging, and they are very cognizant of the fact that the Western healthcare system, regardless of who pays the bill, isn't working. They need to design it differently. This country back in the 70s shot the people that were probably most important to helping us get it done. They were health systems planners. And we got, because they got in the way of the healthcare system buying more technology and putting it into their hospitals. And if we really spent the time, which what we're doing in Binhai, new area of Tianjin, China, and what we're doing in the Middle East, is we're helping them design, we just set up Qatar's system started with pregnant women, on how to manage their populations better. So looking at populations, building the system to support them is everybody's problem. The World Health, the World Economic Forum just 2 years ago said healthcare costs are one of the top two drivers of the world economy. So it's not solved anywhere else yet.
There's no one you could say is doing a good job of the Western world countries. There's no one we can look to at all.
There are some people that are doing it, but they're fundamentally different forms and they don't have the innovation that we have. But I think there is a model that needs to emerge around designing the system to support the population. It's, and they're largely quite frankly, economies without insurance as a mechanism. It's more government support of the infrastructure of the system.
It's also important to realize that there is no one solution because there is no one homogeneous set of people. We all are different countries, different demographics, different beliefs, different value sets. So I think in constructing, there is no system that's best in the world because the different populations are so different, and how they view healthcare is so different, and how they view each other and society and their role in society is so different that I think leaping to a position where we say, oh, that country does it better, doesn't work because that country is very different, whatever that country might be, in its demographic makeup from us as America.
I'm not sure where the microphone is right now. Is there somebody there?
Yeah. Looking at the health exchanges, which are starting in, I guess, 99 hours, it seems that one of the keys will be enlisting young people. Would you like to talk about some of the barriers that you think you're going to encounter there?
So, first of all, let's be clear. You can buy beginning October 1st. You can buy to get insurance for 2014 all the way to December 31st. Actually, you can buy into all the way to March 31st. So don't make, you know, October 1st like this big date, and if it doesn't all go well on October 31st, you know, all hell is going to break loose. It's going to be a catastrophe. You know, we have 3 months before opening day, as
Six
it were,
months.
Where Aetna and others have to begin providing care. So I think we've reified October 1st way too much in my humble opinion. So the Congressional Budget Office and all the fiscal projections are based upon 7 million total people signing up for the exchanges in the first year, so that would be in the first 6 months, with, of that, 2.7 million of them being young people. Now, I think we're actually going to see that and probably more. And I think we have had a communication problem. I think it's improving. People are talking about the exchanges. But I'll give you, you know, a couple of my stories. I was talking to a guy who's a gardener from California for part of a book that I'm doing on healthcare. And, you know, his guys don't make a lot of money, $17,000 working 6 days a week, 8 hours a day. And he wants to provide them health care. And he says he's gone out and gotten bids, $500 a month per worker. He can't afford it. He now is hearing about the California exchanges. He's seen the premiums. He says at $200 or slightly under $200 a month for his people, he can afford it. And he's going to do it. Now, is he generalizable? I think if you look at the California exchange, and it's not the only one, the prices there are pretty remarkable. You know, if you're a 25-year-old non-smoker, you're going to be able to get a product for about $34 a month subsidized at 150% of the poverty line. $34 a month, $400 a year. That's a pretty good deal. So I think the real question is, how good are the deals out there? And I think the deals for most young people after the subsidies are going to be pretty darn good. Remember, again, young people up until age 30 don't need to buy a full plan. They can buy a catastrophic plan. And again, this is another way of inducing them into the experience of buying insurance. The key number you have to keep in mind to look at on April 1st is going to be 2.7 million young people. Is that the number that's gotten in or not?
Yeah, I think we have time for maybe one more question. We won't wait for the microphone. It's a small room. Go right ahead.
Yeah. Okay. All of you have talked about how care is provided to people and decisions made by doctors, by payers, et cetera. What about decisions made by patients? There doesn't seem to be much discussion about that.
Well, that's really been the focus of my attention, certainly in our company, is to get our employees both informed, motivated, given the proper incentives and the proximity of care. Now, in our case, we have high concentrations of people. We can bring care directly to where they work. Our folks work all three shifts. They work weekends. By bringing a variety of care providers right on site, we can make it easy for this partnership to work. And I think we're going to need to find that sort of thing. We're going to need to find alternative models of care where we can enter into what amounts to a partnership with employees and say, together we have to address healthcare costs and the health of you and your family. And to do so, we're going to provide information, we're going to provide counseling, we're going to provide on-site resources, and you're going to provide the willingness to really engage in this in a way that is not passive as it has been historically, but is informed and active and well-intentioned.
I think the carrot and the stick works for immediate consequence. And so if you're talking, but if you're talking to a 27-year-old about diabetes, you know, I try it on my kids all the time, you lose them after, let me tell you about metabolic syndrome. And then they just tune out. And they're looking at their, you know, their handheld device and they're talking to their friends. Because the consequences are too far away. But if you make it simple and convenient, you bring the people to the workplace, you don't have to wait 40 minutes for a CBC in some hospital that you had to pay $10 for parking to go to, and you can get it at CVS on the way to work in the morning, you have a fundamentally different experience and people will engage.
In addition,
so that's the bet. Make it simple.
In addition, honesty and communication. Right? So you have to freely communicate with the patients, make sure that they understand the ramifications of what they're doing, both short-term and long-term, and be honest with them. So I think that's absolutely critical. The only thing I would add to the exchanges is that we don't need to reinvent the wheel. We know what's going to happen. We lived it in Massachusetts. I've lived it for years in Massachusetts. And that's the one problem I had with the ACA is it did, while it replicated a lot of what we had done, it didn't learn from the mistakes we made.
I'm going to have to stop it there. I'm afraid we've overreached our time. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for a wonderful conversation.
Nice to meet you.
Learned a lot. Pleasure's mine.
Thank you.
Lucky to see you.
And please, everyone, join us for drinks.
Always.
Nice to see you.
Hey, pleasure to meet you. Oh, excellent.
Fights continue, right?
Oh, now I'm all taken.